What is literacy and how does it work? The definition I love is borrowed from my favorite teacher, Paulo Freire, in his book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed. Simply said, literacy is knowing how to critically read the word and the world. Isn't that beautiful? I like to expound that reading the word means critically analyzing books within various contexts for meanings. How to critically read the world means so many things. How to analyze a painting, a situation, a person's body language, how to analyze news, stories, governments, technologies, the world. If parents are not literate at the basic definition of knowing how to read and write, then their children are at a big disadvantage. This is the reason why I strongly advocate for a bilingual or trilingual education in Belize. A topic for another time. The author of the book Social Linguistics and Literacies, Dr. Paul G, shared his research on how culture and society contributes to a person's languages, intelligence, literacy, and identity. He named these discourses that shape a person's identity as one primary discourse and two secondary discourses. Dr. G shares how these discourses help children to become literate in many areas. He mentions that mainstream children have access to both primary and secondary discourses, and this places them on the road to success. It's similar to Lev Vygotsky's spontaneous and scientific concepts highlighted in the book Thought and Language. Example of primary discourses are English language, computer language, news language, exposed at home. Secondary discourses, on the other hand, are languages that children learn outside of the home. For example, music language, theater language, programming language, English language. Anything learned outside of the home is a secondary discourse. Lev Vygotsky calls secondary discourses scientific concepts. Mainstream children who don't need ESL, English as a second language instruction, use the classroom space mostly to acquire secondary discourses or scientific concepts, while non-mainstream children use the classroom to learn the spontaneous concepts. This means to learn English, ESL, students are not ready for secondary discourses or scientific concepts if the language of instruction is new to them. Paulo Freire said, in essence, resisting change is necrophilia. I love that. Because we need to value and take into account our students' native language. That means we need to be in favor for progress, not regress. Not acknowledging that most Belizean children are English language learners and teaching them as English is the language and only language they should be speaking looks like teachers are placing the cart before the horse. Therefore, it is important to build a children's identity kit, building the individual based on the various discourses he or she brings into the classroom. Taking an additive approach to learning will build a child's literacy. Dr. G found that children from non-mainstream homes often do not get the opportunity to acquire secondary discourses, including those connected with the school in their homes due to their parents' lack of access to these discourses. This is so applicable to our Belizean context. Most of our students are English language learners. I've echoed that before. But the child does not fully develop the native language and are not literate in their native language. Yet, during the age of which they are acquiring their native language, which is spontaneous concepts, they're sent to school to learn scientific concepts taught in another language. And that language is treated as the language, not having fully acquired, developed their spontaneous and primary discourses, not fully acquiring their own language. Vygotsky warned in his concept of zone of proximal development to be careful. If the child is not ready, we might be harming instead of arming the child with the tools for success. We are asking children to tie their shoelaces before they have mastered hand coordination or before They even understand which is their right foot and left foot. So the next question I want to ask is, are we equipping youth with relevant literacy? Dr. Sylvia Scribner, in her article entitled Literacy in Three Metaphors, mentioned that functioning literacy came from the need that arose during World War I. There are different types of literacy. And she said that this need came at a time when soldiers were needed, and these soldiers needed to develop specific skills to function as men in combat. Then she mentioned that there is literacy as power. And she said that most rulers, kings, dictators controlled what was disseminated to subjugate the masses. So in essence, only the elites had access to literature. No surprise there. And then there is literacy as a state of grace. I am very familiar with this metaphor of literacy because of my Christian background. Our British legacy of the church state school system in Belize, this literature as a state of grace, is still revered in classrooms. Almost every church state school has a religion class and other religious school activities that students are required to attend. This is a double-edged sword. However, I refuse to see my Christian upbringing as negative. Instead, let's look at it as positive. It is in the name of Christianity that a lot of poor people like me were given a chance to become literate in both my native Spanish language and in the English language. So, good. To answer this question, we are equipping our youth with literacy, but mostly with the literacy as a state of grace. We don't deserve it, but here you go, you poor thing. Here you go. I enjoyed reading the Bible because of its many stories and because it was literacy as salvation and literacy as a state of grace. But in high school, I did have other types of literature. For example, Shane, Lord of the Flies, excellent book, Anne Frank, To Kill a Mockingbird, Animal Farm. When reading that book, it was the first time I learned the word pseudonym. His real name is not George Orwell, it is Eric Blair. Of Mice and Men, A Tale of Two Cities, Green Days by the River. We read a lot of Caribbean books. Now the question is, were these books relevant to me as a youth? Because we do really need to make sure that the literature is relevant to our youth. I cannot say I did not learn about the word and the world. I learned a lot, but I still felt inadequate, not because I lack critical thinking or intelligence, but because I have felt inadequate when speaking Spanish to people who speak Spanish at the cognitive academic language proficiency level, or to anyone who was raised and educated in a Spanish-speaking country. I have felt inadequate when speaking Creole, Belizean Creole, because I still struggle speaking it with enthusiasm. I have felt inadequate when speaking English in formal settings, and especially to people who speak English as a native language. As you can see, it explains why I have been battling with the imposter syndrome. Most of my youth, I have been consuming literature written in English and with characters that I had nothing in common with. I was almost never encouraged to produce literature, and that it is important. Writing was not nurtured at school, in primary or secondary school, maybe, but they didn't check what I wrote. Writing was my escape from the pain of having to experience a broken home, and from there, many foster home experiences. I was a private writer. I write to forget, I still do. I write to heal, I write to remind myself of how strong I am, I write to create fantasies of my real world experiences that are basic and bland, I write to keep my doppelganger alive, I write to organize the Venus retrograde effect in my life, I write to keep melancholy at a distance, I write to avoid causing great pain to those I love, I write to recreate myself every day. I write to become a better version of myself. I write to control myself. I write to discipline myself. As a youth, I would have loved to be encouraged to write. I write mostly to conquer the demons that plague. And most of our youths are suffering, and writing is a good way to let them release all that pain and anger. In essence, our youth suffer many literacy issues that are a result of complex issues they had to deal with or suffer over the years in classrooms with teachers who are not culturally competent, who stagnate or alienate their voices. These teachers carry out hegemonic discourses without knowing it. They follow the banking concept without knowing it. The banking concept is the idea where teachers preach and talk to students. They see students as empty vessels that need to be filled. Our long-term English language learners of almost all cultures in Belize have been denied a voice and opportunity to promote their cultural wealth because they do have a lot of cultural capital they bring to the classroom. From the onset of education, the banking concept has alienated individuals by looking at the deficits, impeding students to truly embrace their cultural identity and language. This is a complex issue that has roots in politics, ethics, economics. The curriculum is also an area to investigate and reform. The non-culturally sustainable curriculum previous to tertiary level education has denied our English language learners identity discourses. Belizean students have multiple realities, and at their core, they have been deeply affected by this banking system. The phenomena to forget self has produced automatons in the classroom, in society, and in homes. And at the tertiary level, students feel reluctant to share their experiences. Knowing their culture, identity, and language were not embraced in the educational system. And suddenly, at the tertiary level, we're asking them about all these things. When we examine their realities, they share identity issues. Identity issues affect their intellectual growth and learning, it does. And that's a topic for another time. Recently, I had the opportunity to attend a live Facebook lecture series with Dr. Debbie Reese, who is passionate in sharing on how to counter narratives that are unproductive. She shared sentiments on how teachers can share counter narratives in a classroom in a healthy way, in a productive way, in a healing way. She was a part of a group that credited their book infographic entitled Diversity in Children's Book in 2018. I saw this infographic and I noticed that 1% of the books in the classrooms were about Native Americans and 5% Latinos. And I was shocked. I realized that this was my reality when attending primary school and high school. I did not read any books depicting the mestizo culture. Not even in Spanish class. I don't recall reading a Spanish book in Spanish class, literature book I'm referring to. It was no surprise to see that most children books published in 2018 were 50% accounted to be white. All my Spanish book readings were at home or in a library where I chose what to read. I would have loved to read the adolescent short stories and essays. All adolescent short stories I have read as an adult serve a purpose: to voice youth's strong opinions and to advocate for those inadequacies they observe that adults impose on them. And some of the examples of these very good essays are Flowered Girl by Juliana Partridge. Speaks of her refusal to be classified into a group because her background is too rich and at times complicated to fit into one label or one ethnic group. Also, the story An Adopted Korean by Hae Ok Miller speaks of being adopted by South American families, which resulted in her proudly owning her Latina roots, but at the same time, her heart longed to learn the Korean culture and meet her Korean family. She demonstrates that society is ready to judge and label when the reality is we must not judge at face value. I also enjoy and could relate to Lauren Silverman's Hunger Diaries. His teacher, the character in this book, his teacher, aware of his home situation, but not sensitive enough, she embarrassed him, forever traumatizing him. Great stories giving voice to these youth experiences, giving us adults a chance to look at how sensitive and vulnerable youths are. Just as adults, so we must be conscientiously aware of the affective at play when it comes to dealing with youth in the classroom. We need to bring in culturally relevant literature for them. The next question is, are we preparing our youth with digital literacy? At school, I have observed that most youths are reluctant to use technology as a tool and space to share their writings. Belize is small and it means that everybody knows everybody. And this is not the only reason, but as the National Council of Teacher Education in the article called Definition of Literacy in a Digital Age, most of these positions, I tested them to see if our Belizean youths are doing these things. Belizean high school and college level students have these skills or not, or are trained or have access to these resources. I was ticking them one by one. And I found that I wrote no more than yes to almost all of them. I strongly believe that most of our youths are not technologically literate. Most don't see themselves as advocates. Most are not confident enough to allow themselves to be vulnerable, to engage in conversations in public spaces, to explore and have a voice in open spaces, in communities online and in physical environments. Most of our youths have these invisible blinders that prevent them from exploring the possibilities of how to administer or even use technology for educational or even business purposes. Most can only use social media such as Facebook and Instagram. And this brings to mind Lauren Esposito when she recounts her first day of classes at a college. She recollects on her past writing pedagogy and expounds on how having students write on their personal experiences in places within their community help develop their writing. This is what we should be doing. How do we do that? Esposito especially explains the importance on having students focus on outward to a range of local audiences and communities being affected by the issues they raise in their writing. She reiterates that once students are given the opportunity to write about places meaningful or not so meaningful to them, they select their audiences, style, context. The purpose is to design a public service announcement that is relevant to the student and to particular audience, and then exploring digital channels to share these writings. I have done these types of writing activities. Our Belizeans are reluctant and up not to share their e-portfolio, which is a Google site that these students can make public if they wish to. And so this brings to mind Wilcox and Jeffery, and they say that we must encourage effective stance, encourage students to talk about their feelings, and this is very difficult with my students. My students rather epistemological stances where they talk about different other topics, and they prefer using second or third person automatically instead of the first person. I struggle having them to write in the first person, and when I do, they still switch into second or third person.